combination of factors, you know, when we get to have conversations
Sure.
about transport, you know, it seems like a conundrum. It seems like a waze, make that maze rather. But when you talk about, you know, the jeepneys at first, when we talk about the consolidation program, 81% of jeepney drivers, you know, operators have complied with the consolidation and will be in the transition process more or less to modern PUVs. From your data, from your studies, is this rate enough to fulfill the demand of the commuters?
You know, unfortunately, Migs, the government has yet to be transparent about the information that they've gathered. What we need to understand from government now is, where is that 81% distributed? Quite recently, there was an article that came out that's enumerating which areas would be affected. And I think out of all the areas, Metro Manila will be the hardest hit in terms of the number of routes that would be affected by the PUV modernization program, consolidation program. So in all honesty, there is no data out there because the LTFRB and the government in general hasn't really been very transparent with the information. So it's very hard to gauge. There will be areas that would result to an oversupply, and there will be areas that would result in undersupply. And we need to be able to get information from the government to make sure that despite the consolidation deadline, no commuters will continue to suffer. And that's something that we've always asked the government to share with us the data. And this is across all issues in transportation. We've always been calling for government to be a little bit more transparent when it comes to data. Now, when they release numbers like 81% and so on and so forth, we really don't understand how this number is distributed, what areas would be affected, what specific routes would have oversupply or no supply at all.
Well, when you talk about a concrete data, 10,000 jeepneys have not complied, more or less 10,000 units have not complied. Will this have a dent on the commuting public? Well, talk about estimates, right? 10,000 sure. Jeepneys, and when you distribute it all across the Philippines, you know, just to estimate. What do you think?
Sure. Sure. Absolutely. You know, Migs, as early as pre-pandemic, we've already seen how the jeepney supply and the supply of transportation in general is insufficient. And then the pandemic happened and the government suspended all franchises. And then as the pandemic was starting to ease out, the government took its time in reactivating the franchises little by little. So you can already imagine how the banning or the inability of those that weren't able to consolidate to operate would really impact the supply of public transportation. This would greatly affect, of course, the welfare of ordinary commuters, majority of which, around 88%, it's pegged at, would be having problems getting to work or getting to school.
Now, Ira, just for context, you know, just to take a step back and for our viewers, you know, really trying to understand, because there have been so many transport strikes by the PUV groups in and out. It has been a tug of war, right, between the government and the PUV groups like Manabela and Piston.
Sure.
But make that, just to contextualize, you know, when you talk about the effect of these jeepneys, you know, going modern, quote unquote, just take us through the pros of these things.
Sure.
And then, you know, when we go to the other side as well, what Manabela and Piston is fighting for. But make that for the modern first, you know, going modern, the pros on why the government is really doing this.
Sure. First of all, the objectives of the PUV modernization program is great. What it aims to deliver is to be able to improve the commuting experience of ordinary Filipinos. It will ensure that there's sufficient supply, that public transportation be reliable and safe. However, it's in the implementation where we find the problem. For instance, the government continues to lack the completion of the LPTRP, or the local public transportation route plan. The LPTRP is what local government units are supposed to deliver. And what this would answer is the need, just is the specific need of each of the local government units in terms of the number of GP supplies and in the routes that are needed to be serviced. When all of these LPTRPs are submitted and approved by the government, it would then have to be translated into a route rationalization plan, which to simplify would, number one, make sure that there's no overlapping of services. And number two, would make sure that all areas are serviced. Now, this is supposed to be steps one and two of the PUV modernization program. After this should then be the consolidation deadline so that the different GPA groups would know then into how many franchises, into how many routes they're supposed to consolidate under. Unfortunately, the government flipped the order. They've prioritized consolidation deadline.
Yes, exactly. Consolidation first, right?
And up until now, we have yet to hear from the government in terms of the completion or the status of the LPTRP in the route rationalization plan. Now, this is very important, Migs, because a proper route rationalization and a proper consolidation is what will create profitability for the jeepney operators. And only then and only then can we discuss the purchasing of new units, because then you'd need to make sure that the jeepney operators are at a certain level of profitability before they can afford the brand new units. Mind you, that the cost of each of the units vary from 2.5 to 3 million, right, and government support is no more than 200,000 pesos. So these two things are there.
Right. Yeah, that's right. It's an arm and a leg. It's an arm and a leg for most jeepney drivers.
Absolutely, and at the level of at the state at which they operate, it's very impossible and very difficult for them to make enough money to cover for the amortization of the brand new GPs. So that's issue number one. It needs to be implemented. So while the objectives of the PUV modernization plan is good, it's the implementation that's very problematic, and this is probably where pushback on the program is coming from, which is why it's very important. And we've been asking the government to do this, to have an earnest discussion between themselves, the operators, the industry members, and also for civil society organizations and academia like ourselves, so that we can create a new plan that makes sure that all concerns are met. Which is why, in a statement that we released, we were drilling on three main points. One is that no commuter should suffer because of the consolidation deadline, no one should lose their source of livelihood, and that they should meet with all the stakeholders to make sure that we are able to design a good program.
Right. No, Ira, you know, when you talk about the route rationalization plan, it's like a route in the, it's like a train route, right? It's like a subway route. It's like, you know, bus routes, like let's say when you go to other Southeast Asian countries where it's just like a code, that's where you go. And then that's where you should expect from the bus stop, et cetera. So that gives a clear picture on why maybe the pushback is happening. It's because when you are the jeepney driver, you're going to consolidate. And then what happens, right?
Right.
So and the cost of a unit is around, you mentioned, around seven digits, right?
Right.
And then so you wouldn't know what would happen next.
But right. So if you're government is unable to, so if the government continues with this order of things, what might happen down the line is the government might end up having to ask the GP drivers to reconsolidate, which is not efficient, which is a redundant process.
Yes,
so it's very important that as early as now, the government thinks about this.
But that deadline has passed. April 30 has passed, and I mentioned around 10,000 plus units have not complied. When you talk about
That's true.
Number one, no commuter shall suffer, right? With this number, do you think, will this have a dent? Will now the public be forced to go on different modes of transportation? And what would be that effect? Let's say we're just going through the numbers, right? It's just a linear data. Mm-hmm. And then most likely the 10,000 units will not service this amount of commuters. What happens that happens next?
I mean, absolutely. There's definitely going to be a problem for a lot of commuters, because as I mentioned, as it is, even before the consolidation deadline, we already have a problem in terms of supply. You know, you need to be able to rationalize that supply to make sure that the needs of commuters are met. Not only should is it a matter of there being jeepney units flying the routes, but that there should be jeepney units flying across, throughout the entire day. And this spills over into other problems, such as, if there is a lack of supply of public utility vehicles, are people then able to choose other modes of transportation, like for instance, biking, or say light electric vehicles and personal mobility devices? But as you can see, Migs, on the other hand, another group of another government agency is restricting the use of public of light electric vehicles, personal mobility devices, and electric bikes and bikes, and so you've got this problem where it's very obvious that the left hand is not does not know what the right hand is doing, and so while the public is looking for alternatives to an unreliable public transportation system, you have another government agency that's making it difficult for people to resort to other forms of transportation.
So that's like a mind-boggling maze, as I mentioned. And well, I'll go now to that issue where you know you have bike lanes in EDSA. Right,
sure.
But then suddenly you're taking out the bike lanes. What happens next?
Exactly. So that's exactly what I'm trying to point at. While we are unable to fix our road-based public transportation, people are now resorting to other modes of transportation, such as like electric vehicles, personal mobility devices, and bikes, which is now being considered to be removed or banned from national roads. You know, Migs, there are, if we base it on the study conducted by the Institute for Climate and Sustainable Cities, or ICSC, the Mobility Awards, and Bilang Bisikleta, there are at least 8,000 bikers on EDSA on a daily basis. So these are people that would be affected by this policy. And the only reason for and the only way for us to be able to address, so I'm going to zoom out now. Our goal here, and I'm sure the goal of government agencies, is to be able to improve the mobility of everybody. And if you have policies such as the PUBMP that does not seem to be well thought out of, and policies that ban other modes of transportation, then you are not able to address people's mobility. This is where the precedents. Call comes in, which we are starting to wonder what's happening to it. Because if you recall, about a month ago, the president called for a comprehensive plan to address our transportation issues. And we've yet to hear some solid steps taken in that direction.
Now, if you ban the bike lanes, just, you know, thinking from a practical approach, if they want to get from point A to point B, like let's say Magallanes to North EDSA, then suddenly you have to take alternate modes of transportation. You may need for jeepneys now, but then right. You have a lack of jeepneys, an undersupply
exactly.
In some areas.
Exactly.
Right.
So that's a problem that we're seeing. The government is so this is all symptoms of the government's inability to address the core issue, that there is a lack of an ecosystem that coordinates all of these systems of transportation. And that's where we need to start. We need to sit back. We need to take a step back, and come up with a comprehensive plan to really understand the needs of ordinary Filipinos, how they get to work, what is that journey like for people. And you start off with a very basic thing like sidewalks. When people step out of their house, the first mode of transportation is, of course, walking. And then they walk to the nearest public transport stop, where there has to be a sufficient supply of public utility vehicles that would then take them, perhaps, for example, to a rail station that would take them on to work, and so on and so forth. So this is the kind of thinking that we've been trying to convince the government to do, to have a comprehensive, to have a bigger look at the issues.
Yes, Ira, I'll just like to shift the gear. We've been seeing some, although not all, maybe cities or some municipalities that have Euro 4 modern jeepneys. What have been the benefits of that so far?
You know, makes the problem, again, we're not really supposed to, at this point, we're not supposed to be focusing on the type of unit just yet, up until we get to a point where the jeepney drivers and the jeepney operators are at a level of profitability where they can afford to pay for these units. Now, also makes Euro 4 is actually outdated. In other countries, we're already looking at Euro 6 or even maybe Euro 7, if I'm not mistaken. So we shouldn't even be talking about the type of vehicles, because the prescribed vehicle, as we know it, is already outdated in a lot of other countries. So that's number one. Number two, the consolidation that's happened for some does not really does not really reflect the type of consolidation that we need. All the majority has done is that they group themselves together in a cooperative. But a functional consolidation should also reflect in the type of fleet management. For instance, if you have a lot of members, there should be a proper dispatch system to make sure that the right amount of units are out in the streets. So for non-peak hours, you have less units. And for peak hours, you have more units. So this is how they're supposed to operate. But there has to be a system to make sure that whether or not you're operating, you're also receiving the same amount of salary. So that's the kind of solution. That's the kind of consolidation that we mean. So not So when the government talks about consolidation, all it really means is that operators and jeepney drivers have grouped themselves into cooperatives. But there's another conversation of making sure that they do operate efficiently using a proper fleet management and a proper dispatch system.
Now, Ira, I'm just wondering, just from your studies or maybe from your opinion, let's say, you know, this modernization program pushes through 3 years from now. So by 3 years from now, we should be at least expecting Euro 6, Euro 7 vehicles, right? Because you're saying now it's outdated. 3 years from now, that's 2027, it should be at least from that caliber. Now, let's say from that theory, right? A jeepney driver or a jeepney operator undergoes a modernization program. He goes through the loan, 2 to 3 million. He charges 13 to 15 pesos jeepney fare, gets more passengers, etc. But there's one school of thought. Like, let's say I may be earning more, but that goes to the loan, right? I'm paying off my debt. But what's an ideal situation now for a jeepney driver to, you know, at least save, right? And have a more comfortable, lead to a more comfortable situation despite paying off some debt.
Sure. And that's where the government should come in. You know, what makes it funny here is that government seems to be very good at removing themselves from the equation. So there's a level that the jeepney drivers have to be able to make in order for them to operate properly. And then there's also that level where that consumers or that commuters can afford to pay. And the gap in between is a subsidy that the government should be taking care of and should cover to make sure that jeepney drivers and operators have sufficient funds or sufficient earnings to, number one, pay off the loans, and number two, live a very comfortable life.
Yeah. All right. So, well, again, it's like a gridlock. It's like a traffic that we still can't get out of, because when you solve one thing, it creates another thing, right?
So, which is why it's so important, Migs, for the government to really come up with a comprehensive plan. As the president has said, what he wants are less of piecemeal solutions, but a comprehensive plan. But it also needs, and I'm going to go back and join your narrative there. There has to be a driver. There has to be a government agency that's in charge of leading this discussion. And the way we see it, two to four government agencies are all playing a role in our mobility. And there needs to be now a lead government agency that would lead the discussions to make sure that piecemeal problems or symptoms of these problems, like, you know, lately we've been talking about the PNR suspension. Now we're talking about PUVMP. There was the popularity of e-trikes and e-bikes. All of these are just symptoms that the government is unable to deal with the core issues at hand. And so a comprehensive plan is really what we recommend. And there has to be a lead agency that would lead all of the other agencies in coming up with a solution.
When you talk about, lastly, Ira, when you talk about symptoms and we talk about managing those symptoms now, because when you mentioned about the plan, it's a macro perspective, right? But
sure.
Now for the daily commuter, for us citizens, what are the practical ways where we can contribute, you know, to the ease in traffic, to be able to make our lives better in terms of commuting, not just for the commuters, but also for the transportation stakeholders as well, like the jeepney operators, the drivers, the TNBS drivers, etc.
Well, number one, we need to do our part in pressuring government to come up with a comprehensive plan that would really solve our problems once and for all. The current situation makes everyone is losing. in this current situation, whether you're in a car, you're in a bike, or taking a public utility vehicle, everyone is losing. And so we need to really force the government to come up with a comprehensive plan, a real solution that will once and for all improve our transportation, our mobility needs. And number two, I guess as ordinary citizens, we just need to be nicer to each other on the road.
Mm-hmm. All right, so there you have it. Alt Mobility Philippines Director Ira Cruz. Nice talking to you again, Ira, and happy weekend.
Yep, good speaking with you. Thank you, Migs.
Thank you, Ira.